The following review is rated A for adult content. You should be 18 or over to watch this show. ADTV comments do not reflect the views of Knox Pro Entertainment or any other federation.
What is up, fans of the adult demographic? ICO is back. Webcam hacking it this week because my boy Hebrew Heat, motherfucker, left the goddamn charger at Knox Pro. So now for the next freaking week, because Hebrew Heat is leaving Thursday morning to go up with to Frisco with the boys from Knox Pro. I'm a little jealous of the motherfucker, I gotta admit, but at least I don't have to deal with his ass for a whole week. And unfortunately, he won't be on this Thursday's Impact Review. You're stuck with me, you're stuck with my damn Nikon Cool Pics freaking camera, and that's pretty much the way it goes. I hope the green screen and everything comes out great on the review. Other than that, fans, this is going to be a simple review for Raw. I apologize for not getting it out last night. Quite simply, I had to switch the Time Warner cable, and I don't get done watching the show till 11 o'clock now on the West Coast. And after working all day drinking and smoking, quite honestly, I just didn't have the freaking energy to do it. So Raw's going to go like this. I'm just going to give you a few things that I liked and a few things that I didn't like. But before I get into that, I got to give a shout out to my subscriber of the week. I've been neglecting that lately. Subscriber of the week goes to J.K. Jigsaw. That's J-I-G-S-A-W-Y-E-R. You are my subscriber of the week. And what about Val Venus coming back to the WWE? I mean, again, you know, you heard about the story over the weekend. He signed a deal with sort of William Regal, basically, you know, with WWE. Now, you know he's not coming back as a talent. They're probably going to use him backstage as a road agent. If that's the case, more power to Sean Morley. I wish him the best of luck. And what about Lita on Raw last night? Someone clue me in on why she was there. Did her band, I mean, they were in New York City, and their band was, you know, maybe having a show there? I'm not sure, because they were in Long Island last night. I don't know. I'm just kind of curious on that. Other than that, the Raw rating got a 3.3 as well. That was released earlier today, so it's kind of on par with what they've been doing lately. Unfortunately, SmackDown, though, on the other hand, the ratings kind of dipped to the level where they first were before they got put on the Sci-Fi Network. Hopefully, the ratings start shooting up. I want to see them get over a 2. If they can get over a 2 on SmackDown, there'd be some good things to come. Now, on to the Raw review. And basically, I just got to start off by saying, Linda McMahon, you know, you are not going to get fucking elected to the Senate, okay? I hope you guys went out and voted today. Proposition 19 is the big deal out here in California, baby. That's right, you got to vote yes on that because that makes it legal to blaze it up, baby. Get crumped, like the R-Truth way. Here's what I liked about the show. I start the show with a positive note. I actually liked the segment backstage with R-Truth and Cena. Now, I know you're saying, why the fuck did you like that segment? Look, here's why I liked it. It actually created a little bit of, you know, mystery. It's like Cena actually, they dropped a little bit of heel undertones in his persona. It's the way that he responded to R-Truth. He kind of like walked off on him. I kind of like this. You know, granted, he's 99.9% sure not going heel. Okay, at Survivor Series. We all would love it, trust me. I would love it, Hebrew Heat would love it, King Fred would love it, fuck. Most of you fans would probably like it if Cena went heel. Unfortunately, it's just not going to happen. But they are at least doing a good job with this storyline, making the Nexus relevant again, making the storyline, you know, interesting. And as long as they keep doing that, it'll keep me intrigued, and it's good, you know, good for business. Now, Vince McMahon coming back. This is no particular order, by the way. This is number 2. At Dr. fucking Tiny Prince. That's right, fucking Freddie Prince, doing a little acting as a doctor there. With Vince McMahon coming out of the coma. I gotta admit, Vince McMahon, that motherfucker can act. I mean, when Freddie Prince basically said that Linda McMahon blew $50 million on the campaign, I mean, his eyes just lit up. Then he was just basically talking shit on fucking Daniel Bryan being the U.S. champion. I mean, I just loved it. It was entertaining. It was kind of different. And then the whole dream sequence where they went to Stephanie McMahon in her freaking bed, looking hot as hell, by the way, with Triple H, well, not on camera, but his voice in the background. Let me know what you thought about that. Now, that, to me, that just spells that Triple H is the mystery GM. The way he just acted, okay, off freaking camera, you know, I just really think that he is the mystery GM. I actually did like that segment. And yes, talk to me about Lita's appearance. Again, I already talked about it earlier. It was kind of cool in the little diva twister, which, by the way, even for PG, it was still kind of cool. But, you know, it would have been better if it was done on Impact. Maybe when I saw Brian Candy's version of it, but hey. Again, I was kind of cool with that. Now, the Miz Show match. Now, most of you, this is actually probably the best match of the night. In fact, it was. Now, before you jump down my throat and say, well, why wasn't the main event any good? Because the main event had four fucking guys that couldn't work, okay? Two NXT guys in Orton and freaking R-Truth. Come on now. At least Big Show and Morrison, Miz, put on a decent match, okay? I like the fact that this wasn't a comedy match, that Big Show just didn't wipe the floor with him. They actually made it a little bit competitive before the DQ ending. But what I didn't like about the match was the DQ ending. The fact that Miz hit him with the briefcase in his freaking gut, okay, and then hit him in the back. Come on, I know there's no headshots, but it's a freaking briefcase made out of aluminum. Can't you knock the guy in the head? At least make it viable? Because come on, if I hit Big Show with anything in his gut, it's just going to swallow it. I mean, what else can I freaking say? And I also like the fact that they furthered the storyline between the Hart Dynasty. You know, a little dissension still there with the tag team. I really like that because after that match, where basically D.H. Smith was like, hey, motherfucker, lost the match again. It wasn't my fault. I like that. I like the fact that they haven't officially broken up the tag team yet. All signs are there for them breaking up this tag team, but the way it's going, I actually could see them staying for a little bit longer. I could actually maybe see them working this out. I know I'm dreaming, but they should not be broken up as a tag team for at least another year or two. Give them more experience. Let them be one of the best tag teams before you split them up, because they deserve that. They deserve that Hart Foundation, the original push that they had with the belts, you know, for a long period of time and, you know, got over with the crowd and got over with their ring work. Hart Dynasty is there. The younger guys are there. They're just not quite at that level yet where you should break them up. It's just my opinion. And also, I like the fact that Natalya is still getting involved in her storyline with McHeel Taker. I like this, you know, play cool. This is pretty cool. Again, another match at Survivor Series. I'm down with that as well. Anytime you put Natalya, I mean, in a match with any of these Raw Divas or SmackDown Divas, it's just a sight to see. I mean, it is some of the work lately with her and the TNA Knockouts have been some of the best work I've seen in wrestling in the last couple weeks. And that's pretty sad for me to say that, but it is what it is. At least that's what I see it. And yes, I do like the pushing of Ezekiel Jackson. Okay, I understand that he did a job match over fucking Zack Ryder in his hometown, which is embarrassing to say the least. The fact is, this is the way he should have been pushed before Survivor Series, okay? He should have been pushed beating up guys, you know, in the monster role. Kind of like what he had on SmackDown when he was with V. Brian Kendrick before he hurt himself and was out for the last 6 months. Now, when he came back, he should have been packaged the way that he is now. If he continues to be packaged this way, again, all things are showing positive signs for Ezekiel Jackson. And the Santino segment, okay, with Sheamus, and of course later on with the match with him and Kozlov. I hated the segment to start off with, but the match with him and Kozlov, again with Sheamus, furthered the heel heat that Sheamus needs to have. You haven't beat Kozlov clean, which is supposed to fucking happen, okay? I liked it. I liked that Santino, after the match, tried to pay off freaking Sheamus. Busted open his wallet. I mean, that shit was fucking hilarious. I really enjoyed it. And those are pretty much the things that I liked for the Raw show. Now, on to the things I didn't like. And I gotta say, I did not like the segment backstage with Wade Barrett and John Cena. The whole scrubbing his back thing kind of left a little bad taste in my mouth. Especially after you're going to have him clean the toilets first. Okay, at least make the man wash his hands first if you're going to have him scrub some toilets and rub in your back. I mean, if you're going to go Orlando Jordan, at least go clean, alright? I don't fucking know. And the killing of DiBiase. Again, you are completely... I understand Daniel Bryan needs to get pushed. Okay, yes, he got the win. But you are completely killing this guy. You had a good thing going before he got him involved with this feud with Goldust. It seems like that Goldust is getting the upper hand in this feud, and that should not be the case. The end result in this feud needs to be like this. DiBiase needs to destroy fucking Goldust and basically retire him. Make him a fucking trainer. Kind of like what Sheamus did to Jamie Noble, okay? When he supposedly retired him. Do that with fucking, with DiBiase, you might get some credibility, back into the fans' eyes. Pee Wee Herman, my man, loved you back in the day, loved the show, but man, that segment fucking bombed. Completely bombed. The only thing funny about it was the word of the day being ring. That was kind of cool, the segment with Miz, and he kept saying it, and the crowd kept popping. But just the old 80s jokes, the whole persona that he did, it just was bad. I did kind of like it that he wouldn't shake his hand, though. That was kind of funny. They didn't make any reference to that, but I was thinking all along, yeah, we know why you're not shaking his hand. Again, I hate the main event, simply because it was four guys that can't work. I don't care what you Randy Orton fans say. The guy is a horrible worker in the ring. Why do you think all the matches that he has with people, even the top stars in the company, never really turn out that good? Makes you wonder. That's all. And my last fucking thing goes out to, this is a little rant on you fucking stupid adult fans. I'm gonna leave you fans with this. If you are a fan, okay, of a heel stable, like I saw four or five of you motherfuckers in Nexus shirts, when Randy Orton's music comes out, and he's coming out showing the belt and getting all the props from the crowd, you stupid motherfucker started clapping like it's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Hello, the leader of your fucking stable is fighting him at the pay-per-view. If you're a smart fan or an adult fan, why are you cheering for Orton? I don't want to hear about respect. No, it just makes, you're not smart, okay? It just makes you a fucking pandering tool. Jericho would just beat the shit out of you if he saw you doing that. I mean, are you fucking shitting me? Makes no sense to me. Other than that, overall, I give this show solid 5, actually. There were some good things about the show. I like the fact that there was 30 minutes of wrestling over 7 matches. That was kind of cool. I did like the, you know, build up, of course, towards Survivor Series. They put some emphasis on the top matches, which again makes sense. The problem is, it just didn't drive it home, you know? I just didn't like some of the things that they were doing. I didn't like the pandering of the tribute to the troops. I understand you guys do a great job of the troops year in and year out, but, you know, the election's today, okay? By the time you see this, the election was yesterday. I don't get it. I don't get why you're doing that when you're not doing a show this year for the troops. I really wish you were. You could do it, you know, at a base. You don't necessarily have to go to a war zone. But to pander to us like that and also do the whole stand up for the WWE thing. Make sure tomorrow to stand up for the WWE. It's bad enough when now you have federal agents basically looking into you now for trying to give out free merchandise to Connecticut voters. Okay? That's not good. Okay? I don't know, Vince. I don't know what you were thinking with this, but if that is the collusion, that's what they call it in the sports world when you fucking tamper with fucking agents and contracts and free agents. I don't know what is. Okay? Some shit might come down on you. I hope it doesn't. But, you know, I don't know. Other than that, oh yes, fantasy basketball. Okay, I got another minute or two here. If you guys are fantasy basketball fans, I'll put a link in the description box. Basically, you're not going to beat me. You can try. I challenge fans of the fucking Wrestling Revolution to my fantasy football league. I'm 8-0. There's a reason why I am a god when it comes to fantasy sports and why I know my shit. My record is undisputable. My style is fucking impeccable. Don't try me.